Welcome to worship on this 21st Sunday after Pentecost, still in the green or growing season. It is always our prayer that you experience the risen Christ in our midst as we worship together. We like to say that whoever you are or wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome right here with us. Today, we continue with part two of our preaching series called Should I Stay or Should I Go? Based on Brian McLaren's book, Do I Stay Christian? A Guide for the Doubters, the Disappointed, and the Disillusioned. In this ongoing time of COVID, we note that many have not returned to church for more reasons than just contagion. We will talk about some of those reasons as well as highlight reasons to stay. So abide with us as we ponder together. And now let us enter into worship and contemplation with this beautiful music.
Our scriptures this morning come from the book of Micah and also from the letter of 1 John in the New Testament. This from Micah. With what shall I come before the Lord and bow myself down before God on high? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings? With calves a year old, will the Lord be pleased? With thousands of rams, with 10,000 of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgressions, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God? And this short verse from 1 John. Little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in deed and in truth. May God add blessing to our understanding and following this word as best we can.
This is part two of our sermon series, Should I Stay or Should I Go? And the title of my sermon today is Don't Walk Away Mad. Today we are talking about the second reason to leave Christianity and the counterbalancing reason to remain Christian. The reason to leave we will call because of toxic theology. And the reason to stay we will call because of the power and grace of forgiveness. I tell you both poles right up front because I'm first going to cover this thing about toxic theology. But before you get too distraught, I will move into one of the best reasons to stay Christian. That is the power of grace and forgiveness. I will also have you know that the second half of the book, Brian McLaren's book, Reasons to Stay Christian, is significantly longer than the first part of the book, which covers the reasons to go. But let's talk about toxic theology first. This is theology that is not life-giving, theology that does not represent the best thinking and practice in our faith tradition. And I'll describe some of its characteristics and see if any of them resonate with what you were taught in your youth or what particularly strident streams of Christianity are still proclaiming. And right up front, I want to credit Brian D. McLaren for many of the words I use today, as it is his book we are preaching through entitled, Do I Stay Christian? A Guide for the Doubters, the Disappointed, and the Disillusioned. Brian McLaren is a former college English instructor who became a pastor for 24 years. Now he is an author of books including Faith After Doubt and A New Kind of Christian. He is an activist, a public theologian, and frequent guest lecturer for gatherings in the United States and around the world. Okay, what is toxic theology? McLaren frames toxic theology with the declaration that Christianity is stuck. It's stuck because it has reduced the mysteries of faith to belief. And then it went on to codify those beliefs into required belief systems. For many Christians, beliefs are what define them and are simply what Christianity is, a set of propositions, a set of beliefs. You know those required beliefs, virgin birth, physical resurrection, literal second coming, a literal hell, a literal six-day creation, and so on. And the aim of holding to those beliefs is all about getting to heaven when you die. Never mind that Jesus didn't much talk about the afterlife unless specifically asked. Never mind that Jesus talked mostly about how to live with love in this life. Read the Beatitudes if you don't believe me. It may surprise you to know that in the first century, Christians were wildly divergent in their beliefs. For the early Christians, their faith was simply a shared way of life, a way of loving one another, the neighbor, and most importantly, serving the least of these. Go ahead and read the book of Acts, and you will see what I mean about early Christians. But back to this thing about beliefs. Specific beliefs have often been stumbling blocks to people, especially people who love Jesus and are compelled by his message and want to grow into his image. But they cannot hold on to tenets like the literal virgin birth. That just doesn't make sense to them, no matter how hard they try. Others simply find no way to reconcile what they were taught about believing in a literal six-day creation with what evolutionary science continues to tell us. And now more spectacularly than ever with the James Webb telescope as it peers deeper and further back into the universe. And so these Christians who think deeply and get mad and they walk away. They cannot stand to have their intellects constrained. They leave the church and they don't look back. They don't know yet that there are other ways of being Christian. They don't know that there are alternate visions. McLaren asserts that many indeed will not allow Christianity to evolve as our understanding of the universe expands. And unfortunately, those old and many voices still command a lot of airtime. You see, some are still caught in old binaries we likely were raised in, heard in Sunday school. You know what binaries are: temporal versus eternal, matter versus spirit, natural versus supernatural, profane versus sacred, worldly, heavenly, changing, unchangeable. But just over 100 years ago, a fellow named Einstein interrupted the dualistic universe in which many of our creeds were formulated, and we've been slow to catch up. Einstein proposed that energy and matter were less like oil and water, two things that don't mix, and more like water and ice, two forms of the same thing. If you freeze energy, you experience matter. If you accelerate matter enough, you experience it as energy. Matter, you see, is frozen light. Matter and energy were no longer fundamentally different things, but rather they became different expressions of the same thing. Might there be different expressions allowable within Christianity? We, after all, live in a universe that changes, unfolds, and flows. And couldn't our understanding of God be dynamic, flow, and not be fixed in rigid beliefs formulated under old understandings of the world? Oh yes, you could be a terrible human being, but as long as your beliefs were correct, you were Christian, you were going to heaven, as if that were the point of the faith. Never mind all the good Christ-like human beings who just couldn't believe in a literal six-day creation or a virgin birth. Where did that leave someone like me who sees metaphors when other Christian voices demand literalisms? That kind of imposition is toxic. Toxic like so many expressions of traditional Christianity. Toxic like using the Bible to defend slavery. Toxic like justifying female submission and patriarchy, which in so many cases have led to violence and harm to women. Toxic like exclusion, firm boundaries regarding who's welcome in the fold and who's not. Toxic like quarreling over how many angels can dance on the head of a pin. Toxic like Pat Robertson getting downright giddy whenever there's an earthquake, famine, pandemic, war, or rumor of war, thrilled that these are signs of the end and that Jesus is coming soon. What's tragic news for everyone else is good news for them, and instead of empathy, they feel elation. Okay, that's enough toxicity. Let me put you back together again. Why stay Christian after all that baggage? Well, here's why. Because God's forgiveness and grace can always redeem. Reformation can be ongoing. We don't have to stay stuck. Listen carefully to this quote by Howard Thurman, the African-American author, theologian, and civil rights leader. By some amazing, vastly creative spiritual insight, the slave undertook the redemption of a religion that the master had profaned in his midst. Somehow God bestowed upon the slaves enough grace and enabled their forgiveness to see love and put their hope in a God, in a Savior that had been poorly lived by the masters right in front of them. And the slave, by and large, embraced Christianity. Imagine that. Can we not do the same, even with all the toxicities in front of us? Could we not see beyond the toxicities to the tremendous good and peace that always abounds in Christianity, remembering the fruits of the Spirit visible in so many? Think Albert Schweitzer, think Mother Teresa, think leaders of our own little congregation who have done so much with You, Mom, and Healthy Packs and prison ministries and countless other missions through the years. Church is indeed a place where we join up with other passionate people and bring about good in this world for the sake of Jesus and in the manner of Jesus, who always inspires us and calls us to service. I tell you this every year when we celebrate Pentecost. the Spirit Christ breathed on the church at Pentecost set in motion world-changing events. The community gathered on Pentecost gave birth to the church, and God's empowerment to that community went public and continues to do so until this day. The Spirit Jesus had once promised to his disciples set in motion one of the most powerful forces ever known, which hasn't stopped. By the fourth century, the church became the most powerful influence in the world. What started on Pentecost shaped art and thought, education and medicine, philanthropy and architecture. Think of the founding of our great universities, our hospital systems, our understanding of morality, our legal and judicial systems, Dante, Shakespeare, Bach, Mozart, music, social services, and world service organizations. Think of the centuries of art and architecture that God's Spirit has inspired. The paintings and sculpture, the great cathedrals that tell the Bible stories, the stories that can continue to shape us if we don't walk away mad. Know today that there is an alternate vision of our faith, one that needs to be tried again, maybe even as if for the first time. You see, leaving the church defiantly or staying compliantly are not our only options. We remember the greatest blessings of our tradition and all that we've accomplished, even as we face up to its many shortcomings. But hopefully we stay, because we are capable of much more good together, and we humans need community. Let's not become mired down or guilty by association in what some streams of Christianity have become. We are not the Christian nationalists and white supremacists of January 6th, 2021 infamy. We don't burn witches. We are not inquisitors. We aren't praying away the gay. We can be ever reforming and ever forgiving, both of ourselves and one another, confessing our past sins of commission and omission, and accepting God's grace that allows us to start anew each day and reimagine our faith. As we do so, perhaps we will address topics like the long-term environmental cost of short-term economic growth, nationalism, militarism, gun proliferation, white supremacy, economic inequality, and systemic injustice. We need to move past word, speech, and belief into deed. Faith is so much more than believing in the right set of intellectual propositions. Real Christian faith is right practice as we follow in the way of Jesus. I think of the words of Micah and 1 John are apropos here. Micah tells us what God requires of us: to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. And John says, little children, let us love not in word or speech, but in deed and in truth. We have a new opportunity to love like that, love actively, all together, together in church, where we would make the most impact if we stay Christian. It's okay to shed the baggage of old and toxic ways of being Christian as we together re-envision and practice a dynamic faith that expresses itself in peace, justice, and love. So don't walk away mad. Stay with us. Taste and see there's much more to come. May that be so. Amen.
Let us join our hearts together in prayer. We remind you each week that we begin our prayer with a moment of silence. And we remind you also that silence indeed is the voice of God. God speaks to us in the silence like no other way. Let us join together in prayer. Source of all truth, we come to you today humbly and freely, admitting that we struggle and have doubts about the faith that we have clung to for so long. We have seen the damage done in your name throughout Christian history, But we also see the good your holy word has inspired now and in times past. Sometimes the wrongs we see make us mad. And we've been tempted to leave, choosing other modes of community, other Sunday morning activities. But here we are, a few of the faithful huddled together, open to re-imaging the faith you've called us to, committed to the way of Jesus. Be with us in this time of tremendous transition in the world and most especially in your church. Show us the way forward. Help us to reform again and again. We offer up to you now all that burdens our hearts. We pray for comfort and healing for our family and friends. We pray for wisdom and guidance for all in positions of authority. We pray the prayer your Son taught us by saying together, Our Father, who is in heaven, holy be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Hear now the benediction. Let us go today in the way of honesty and integrity. Let us go loving and serving Christ who brings us here to this place. Remember that in God, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, forgiveness and grace abound, even as we wrestle with our doubts and progress to new understandings. Let us therefore go in peace. Amen.